Paul, hit it, sir.
Got it.
Got it?
Yeah.
All right. Couple quick things. I have a plethora of writing prompts up here. If you can't come to the reviews, I do try and put them online. Last night, we had a little bit of difficulty when one of my assistants, who shall remain nameless, hit the wrong button. But we have recovered a little bit of it. So worst case scenario, go. We did short answers yesterday, and then we worked on outlining a long essay. Tomorrow at lunch, I will be available again. And from what I'm gathering, you guys need most of the assistance on the long essay and DBQ, correct?
Yes.
All right, well, look at the short answer thing I put up last night. Because what the short answer, it's the same principle as doing one of the long essays. The difference is, in the short answer, it'll tell you what they want. Like, identify one effect on the Americas of the Columbian Exchange or Triangle Trade. Well, what happened to the people of the Americas? They were all wiped out. Why? Disease killed some. What else? Hard labor, enslavement. What did the Spanish make the people in the silver mines use?
Mercury.
So you guys know all that stuff. You just have to plug it in. Once you explain that, it's the same with the DBQ and the long essay. They just don't specifically tell you identify one effect on America. So we're going to start small. And I'm going to get writing prompts galore. If you can't write the entire essay, write a thesis statement and outline. I'm going to have those outline breakdowns. These, I'm going to have a bunch of them up here. Just grab it, fill it out, write your name on it. But the catch is, can you just come in and throw it on my desk?
No.
No. Come in, Ms. Melega, can you take a look at this? What did I do good, and what did I do? You know, what do I need help on? Look at my writing workshop sheets are all blank. So, anyway, it's here, but you have to use it. So who watched the end of Mao Zedong and Chiang Kai-shek last night?
That's a Chinese thing.
So the rest of us who were too busy to go on YouTube last night, what do we need to do today? Go on YouTube. I've got to ask a question. Tom, did you get a haircut?
I did.
Man, that looks outstanding.
Thank you.
It's almost as good as Lord Destiny's, but...
I can't beat that Destiny's.
You can't. You really cannot. So, and it's been, like, you haven't, like, you know, like, put designs in it. Julia really likes it. So, all right, so please take a look at that, or what's going to happen is not going to make a lot of sense. So, we know that Japanese and Chinese nationalism are intertwined. And the Japanese have transitioned. When Admiral Perry sailed in to Tokyo Bay in the 1850s, what had Japan been doing for the last 600 years? All right? And the national policy of seclusion. So they were still living in the Middle Ages with feudalism, and all of a sudden, this American shows up with a dragon, a steam engine. And have you guys in English class written like, you know, reflections?
Yeah.
Or like in the modern day, when your parents get mad at you, instead of getting in trouble, you guys sit in the timeout chair and you write a reflection on what you did might have actually been. Like Ben's mom makes him write probably one a night. Do I remember what he said better? All right. So he doesn't remember. All right. You gotta look in the mirror and say, oh my God, is what I'm doing really? Is it really working? Is this really the best choice? And Japan does something that no other civilization had been able to do. They go from a Middle Ages feudal economy to a fully industrial one in less than 50 years. Has anybody seen, it's an older movie now, Tom Cruise's The Last Samurai?
Yes, I love
it. All right, It's a fictional movie, but it's about this time period. It's about changing from what they did to something brand new. Remember, China had to do the same thing. When Sun Yat-sen had taken over, who did they just get rid of? The last
emperor.
Last emperor, right? For 5,000 years, China had only known the government by a divine emperor. Now, like, oh my God, what do we do now? So, but where China resists it, Japan is going to jump all over it. And what they're going to try and do is get rid of outside imperialism, Great Britain, France, Mother Russia, the United States. They're going to use nationalism to become something new. So they send their young men out, like this guy, Fukuzawa Yukichi. And Fukuzawa is going to travel to the United States. It's probably Raquel coming. Thank you, man. Fukuzawa goes to San Francisco. Remember, way in the past when Japan was just becoming a country, they sent out their young noble men to go study in China. Now they're going to come back and say, hey guys, this is what they have. Well, Japan says, well, shoot, that worked. We might as well just do it again. So Brandon, Tyree, James, Tom, Ethan, you know, Anson, Alvin, you guys, or Anson, Alvin, Alvin wouldn't go, Anson would, Paul, you know, Taylor, Chase, no, we don't want to send you because you'll never come back. Lord Destiny, can you probably make it? Can you be away from Julie for a couple of years?
Yeah.
All right, so here we go, all right. We're going to send you guys over and you're going to come back and tell us how everything they did actually worked. And he spends all of his time down in the engine room, and he's making drawings, and he's asking questions. They go, what are you doing, kid? And he goes, well, the next time I come to America, I'm going to build my own steam engine, and it's going to be better and more efficient than yours. For the rest of that story, I need you guys to watch the YouTube video. So Japan is going to fully industrialize, and it's 1906. And they've done all this hard work. Who here has ever been in like a music recital, orchestra performance? You're an athlete, you're in the flag corps. You practice and practice and practice. You're one song productions. And after a certain amount of time, what do you want to do? You want to do it, right? The Shrek cast is out there working hard day and night. Now they want to show everybody what they've got. We've worked, we've practiced. So Japan has built this new country. They've got this new military, and they want to show it off. And so they attack poor China. China doesn't even know what's coming. And Japan wins. Japan tells China, look, we're going to set up industry here in your country. And if it's ever threatened by your people, our military can invade to protect our property. China has no choice but to agree. And Japan looks around and they want everyone to tell them, pat them on the back and say, man, you've done a great job. But the Western world says, yeah, but you beat China. Right? China. So? And Japan's like, ugh! No, but we've done all this hard work. Yeah, but you beat China. They're like, well, fine. We will fight a European opponent. All right. We could fight a European opponent. That'll make someone say, man, you guys did a really good job. So they attack Mogadishu. Right? And they attack the Russian fleet over in the North Pacific, like where if you watch Deadliest Catch, where all the crab fishermen are, they sink the Russian fleet and then they declare war. And Russia's like, what does he have? We do not know. And the Russian Navy was also their whaling fleet. And Japan knows that for Russia to attack them, to send their main fleet over from Europe through the North Sea, down through the Atlantic, down past Africa, across the Indian Ocean, up the Pacific, it would take a year. So Russia really can't do anything. They're like, yeah, we defeated Russia. And everyone says, well, yeah, but it's
Russia.
Russia. Like, no, you can't say that twice. Well, yeah, it's
Russia.
No one even really likes Russia. And you blew up a bunch of whaling ships. Like, nobody cares. No, but you got to tell us we did a good job. Well, no, you beat
Russia.
You beat Russia. Oh. Ah. President Theodore Roosevelt, Teddy Roosevelt, steps in, and he's going to negotiate a treaty between Russia and Japan. And the treaty heavily favors Japan. And they're like, man, awesome, we finally did something good. But the second part of the treaty forces Japan to face a secondary role to the West. Yeah, you beat Russia, but they're still not on equal terms. Japan still is on the receiving end of treaties that heavily favor Western countries instead of them. And so they say, how did these Europeans get to be so powerful? What makes them so special? And they said, ah, it's imperialism. Think of Star Wars, Darth Vader and the mighty
Sith,
who works for the
dark side.
And the Emperor is in charge of the
Empire.
All right. No, you know. All right, they rule the mighty Empire. All right, the one of the best movies in the whole series is The Empire Strikes Back. All right, imperial means you're in charge of an entire empire. So how do you become an empire? Think of Rome. Think of Genghis Khan. Think of Darth Vader. We go out and we conquer it. All right, we're gonna go. If you can't stop it, that's your problem. All right. Well, this is our land. Well, can you kick us off of it? No. Well, then it's our land now. Well, but that's not fair. I didn't ask if it was fair. Right. So Japan says we're gonna go out, and we are going to enter the imperialism race so we can compete with the West. We're going to show them that we are just as strong and just as powerful. And so this will create the Empire of the Rising Sun, where the Japanese flag has the red rays coming off of the sun. And to resurrect the power of the empire, we're going to go back to the age of the
samurai.
We're going to get the samurai. Now, we're not going to go back to feudalism. We're going to use the mentality of the samurai, right? The person that's going to keep us, return of the Jedi, return of the samurai. Once again, James, you pierced it. Yeah, you guys use that as synthesis in an essay. Synthesis can be like novels and books. So I forgot to tell you guys that. So look at your reading curriculum. Your nectarine is sieves, your things falling apart, night, all of those things, you can connect it to an English class. Or if, yes, let's pray to God that there is a question about Spanish labor exploitation in the New World, you're all going to mention mercury. And from chemistry class, we know there's the element mercury, and it's highly
toxic.
Don't tell them that your fat, bald history teacher told you about mercury. You claim that. You learned that in
chemistry.
Now you're making connections. Yeah, because you're making connections between what you're learning in history class and you're applying it in other areas. I use history a lot because that's so. But if you can connect it to a novel, to something you read, yeah.
So say something like, oh, virtue is poisonous. We know it's poisonous.
Yes. You know, we know from chemistry that mercury will help amalgamate precious metals. Unfortunately, it's highly toxic and it poisoned the environment, that the water they drank, the food that they ate. That's your environmental science, that's your chemistry.
My life just got 10 times easier.
Remember, what I told the 4 or 5 people who came to the writing clinic, you just want to keep it
simple,
man. Right. You've got to reinvent the wheel, because you only have 35, 40 minutes to crank that sucker out. So just
let it go.
Do you guys have a teacher, or you'll get a college professor, where they want to be open-minded and they want to encourage discussion and debate, but when you write a paper, they want to read what?
They want to read.
Right. So you want to give their position right back. Just give them what they want. Here it is. So, the empire of the rising sun is created. It's going to send around a very young boy, Emperor Hirohito. For hundreds of years, no one knew what the emperor was doing. The shogun was calling the shots. Well, now, Hirohito is going to be the central political figure in Japan. And Hirohito will reign from 1926 to 1989. All right. So my boy is on the throne for a long time. And during the 1920s, when Sun Yat-sun was trying to figure out what to do over in China, Japan starts a move towards democracy. They created a political party system. Yes, sir.
Is the shogun completely eliminated, or
pretty much he's gone? Yes, sir.
Is Hirohito Yamato?
Yes, Hirohito Yamato. Yes, sir.
How did this samurai interact with, like, the people? Is it, like, any different? How was it?
Yes, the samurai are not going to be nobles, but they're going to teach that every person in Japan should be a soldier. And the best thing that you could do in Japan is give your life for the emperor. So it's no longer a higher ranking social class, it's every single Japanese citizen. You are Japanese people, divinely protected by your divine emperor. And so they begin, have you guys seen like the Wave, or like the Hitler Youth schools?
Yeah.
All right, where it's like brainwashing. Kids are going to be taught this in school all the way through. It's a brand new, they take the Japanese samurai code of Bushido and they indoctrinate it into their young children throughout schools in the 1920s. Now, if you watch the podcast, a constitution was written, but the Japanese constitutional model is modeled after the one Bismarck wrote in Prussia, which gives all the power to the to the king. So here's a constitution you guys can put. You can vote, but it doesn't matter. We're going to do what we are going to do. And this is going to be awesome, because during World War I, the big time industrial economies like England, like Germany, and later on the United States were caught up in warfare. So the Japanese had almost no
competition.
All right? Everyone else is tied up, and Japan's over there doing its thing. They are able to make incredible gains because they're not at war with anybody. And when World War I is over, England is financially destroyed. Germany is financially destroyed. France and Belgium are financially and in territory destroyed. And so power shifts westward. The two places that people went to get materials to rebuild Western Europe is the United States and Japan. Now Japan has stuff that everybody wants, but more importantly, they need it. right? So Japan can say, pay up. So by the time World War I is over, countries were seeking goods made by the Japanese. And it gave the Japanese a free hand to expand in Asia. As long as Japan supplied Europe's needs, the Europeans didn't really care what the Japanese did. Going back to what Paul told us a couple days ago about the rape of Nanking, you know, you can't see it from my house, so as long as I get my stuff, I really don't care where you got it from. But this super growth, this incredible warp speed growth, is going to create internal struggles. And the Japanese are unique in the way that they have the incredible ability, and not every culture can do this. They can sacrifice short-term tangible gain for long-term results. When most people work hard, they want an immediate payoff. They want a reward. Well, older people in Japan will say, we'll bust our butts. We'll do all this from scratch. I may not enjoy the benefit from it, but my children and my grandchildren will. And the Japanese are able to do this almost collectively. So I'm going to make an analogy that no one's probably going to get. Anybody like the old-time Star Treks, or your parents watch them, like Jean-Luc Picard? Well, there are the Borg. And they fly around like a giant Rubik's Cube, and they say resistance is futile, the Borg collective, right? Everything the Borg does, they do
together.
Well, that's what Japan is going to do because of nationalism. We are divine. We're protected by a divine emperor. We'll teach our children the code of the samurai. We're the empire of the rising sun. I may not benefit from it, but my kids will. And everyone says, you know, that makes sense. Let's move forward with that. And they're becoming extremely prosperous. But it's just like China before it. It's just like England years before, the urban workers who are now making more money than ever before, who are now prospering, begin to have some problems. While the old people are in the factories busting their butts, they look at the young kids, and what are the young kids doing?
They're messing around,
right? They're not focused. Young people began to emulate the West. They don't dress in traditional garb. Young ladies are wearing poodle skirts and saddle shoes. Young guys are actually wearing like blue jeans and t-shirts. That's not how we dress when we go to school in Japan. How did she dress when she was here, Julia?
I don't really know how to describe it. She kind of wore like these, like her skirts, but they're like long. Yeah. They're like down to her knees.
It was formal. It was kind of like a uniform, right?
Yeah.
Look at you guys. All right. So-called professional. Teachers aren't seeing professionals anymore. I'm wearing a t-shirt. You know, 20 years ago, would anybody be wearing a t-shirt besides a gym teacher? No. Out there in YouTube land, it is Spirit Week. I am a superhero. Matter of fact, I am Captain America. All right? But in a lot of schools, you go to Japan, you go to Korea, you go to China, kids are wearing straight-up uniforms. You guys dress like slobs.
Wait, they dress for like uniforms given by the school?
Yeah.
You swear
a uniform?
It's actually
yeah. If I was in charge of this place, you know, you guys would all be wearing. You guys would hate it at first, but your parents would love it. No, I get you two pairs of khaki pants, go to like JCPenney, Macy's, three pairs of khaki shorts, and you get a black, a gold, and a white button down. And as long as you were wearing khaki and black, gold, or white, That's fine. You can say $125 for everything, and if you rip one or stain one, you get a replacement for free. And then on Friday, you guys could have casual Friday. You think, oh my God, we're like a bunch of little brainwashed robots. No. Now there's no disparity of clothes. Some kids are going to the thrift shop trying to get a pair of jeans, and then some people are going to like Lucky's or Forever 21 to pay like $150 for a pair. I'm like, really? Really? It's called Old Navy. All right, $12. All right. Did you say Plato's Closet?
That place.
What pray tell is that?
They're like a thrift store.
Oh, that's what I'm talking about. All right. $125 for a pair of jeans or $125 for an outfit all year. Bam. But I'm psychotic. So. Bam. So, here it is. Because of this, the older Japanese say, you kids have forgotten the age-old Japanese values of discipline and respect. Go to Asia and watch how an old person is treated. You guys will knock them over. You won't hold the door for them. Do that in Korea, Japan, or China. Find out what happens to you. Right? It's not going to be good. You people need to learn. We've broken with the old ways. Why are we going, we're saying the government, but we're going to treat people the right. How you think? You can get chased in a few seconds. It'll be okay. We want the discipline. We want the respect. And those things also feed into the military. There is a growing rivalry between the military government, the old samurai, and the new civilian government. The military officers who said, you civilians are becoming corrupted. You're becoming entranced with Western Europe. You are corrupting the Japanese government. What we need to do is go back to the old ways of discipline and respect. Yes, ma'am.
Why is there like such a big, I guess not necessarily hatred, but like dislike of like both like West ways and like kind of vice versa, like Eastern ways?
Well, because the Eastern ways are more old school and traditional, and the Western ways are modern and progressive. They will take those who have been in power in the East and remove them from power. Those guys want to cling to it. We're in charge. We don't want to. It's like nobles in like Europe. Like, we just don't want to let go. And the big problem comes when the Great Depression hits. Japan had been doing great things, and then in 1926, there's a massive earthquake that ravages Japan. Same. All right. And just as the Japanese recover from the earthquake, the Great Depression hits. And we think about the Great Depression most so in the United States, but it hit Europe, especially Germany and Japan, even harder. But Japan does what it always does. It begins to dig in. The problem with Japan is its items were of such good quality that foreign buyers during the Depression couldn't afford Japanese products. Japanese stuff was too good. I used the thing in the YouTube, it's like a Honda Accord. You buy a Honda Accord, yeah, it's expensive, but that sucker will run forever. Or you guys riding around in the approved vehicle of Chapel Hill Moms Everywhere, the Honda Odyssey, all right? You getting one of those, all right? And you just keep on rolling, so anyway. All of a sudden, the Japanese warehouses are backed up with goods. They're just stacked up. Nobody's buying them. When this happens, the Japanese are forced to lay off workers. And even in modern Japan, the Japanese will go through incredible lengths not to lay off an employee. We may shift your job. You may have to take a pay cut. But man, we respect, one of the deepest Japanese values is loyalty. Alright? We'll try and keep you, and if we can't, gosh, we're really sorry, but man, we're really trying to do it. And all of a sudden, you're going to see the same thing happen in Germany. All of a sudden, you have a bunch of unemployed workers. And they're angry, like, you know, I'm willing to work, I want to work, I want to support my family. Problem is, there's no jobs. I would love to give you a job, my man, but there just aren't any. And so when this happened, this discontent will be fed by extreme nationalists. Guys that Rachel just asked had been marginalized. The old samurai were gone. Like, you guys should really watch. It's a long movie, man. It's good. All right? Ken Watanabe and, you know, Tom Cruise. The samurai are now back in power. They go, do you know whose fault it is that none of us have jobs?
The West.
And the civilian government who caved into the West. They forgot what made Japan great. They forgot what made us awesome. It was samurai. So we're going to revive the Bushido Code. This is what we are going to do. We've caved into Western demands because our civilian governmental leaders are afraid of them. Well, we're not. And the West has become powerful by taking over the globe. They've raped, they've pillaged, they've dissected this entire globe. You know what? If they can do it, why can't we? All right, that's what we're going to do. So, the Japanese nationalists are also angry at their treatment in the world. They didn't tell us we did a good job when we industrialized and beat China. They made fun of us when we beat Russia. No one ever said, hey, Japan, man, that's awesome. Now, Japan had a lot of help. Great Britain and the United States laid out the blueprint and said, this is how you do it. But Japan and Great Britain were the first two countries in their regions to fully industrialize, going from a feudal economy to an industrial one in less than 50 years, even with help. Man, that's tough. It's hard. It's a great, incredible feat. If you're Japanese, you're like, yeah, all right, look at what we did. But Western countries, especially Australia, Canada, and the United States actually closed their borders to Japanese immigrants. No, you guys can't come in. The Japanese said, what's up with this? All right, why are we doing this? We're proud of our industrial achievement. Why are you kicking, not letting us in? It's a deep, deep insult. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question about Australia.
Yeah.
Are we going to like go over it more? Or are we just going to be like, it's Australia?
I'll do Australia in about 10 minutes, if you would like me to.
I mean, like, you know, if like it's not important, then I don't have to go over.
I will mention it during the period.
I just want to
do it.
Wasn't an island full of criminals?
No, it was a bunch of Aborigines, and then the British kicked their criminals out and said, oh, good day, mate, we're taking over.
I know Georgia was
talking about
this. Yeah.
The Japanese military felt that once again, Japan needed to expand and get more new colonies so the West would acknowledge them, so the West would acknowledge their existence. So the Japanese, once again, are going to invade Manchuria. And they're going to be led by this guy, Hideki Tojo. Right. Hideki Tojo is going to be the new so-called shogun. He's going to be the head of the Imperial War Council. And remember what the Japanese told China. We're going to set up businesses in your country, and if any of them are threatened, we have the right to send in our military to protect our businesses. Remember that from a half hour ago? Taylor.
Can you spell his name somewhere?
H-I-D-E I-K-I-T-O.
J-O.
J-O. Hibiki Dojo. Yes, sir.
Wait, so how can they afford to wage a war with China if they're...
We're not going to wage a war with China.
Yeah.
We're going to fake it. Japanese go over to China, and coming out of an iron ore mine, they blow up their own railroad. Remember the railroad I told you I was going to mention several times? We don't blow it up seven times, we're blowing it up once. Blow up the railroad. Did we blow up the entire railroad? No, they blew up like a 40-foot section, a couple rails. You could fix it in a couple hours. And they screamed, "Oh my God, the Chinese blew up the railroad! The Chinese blew up our railroad! Oh my God, we have to
fight them.
Invade." And the Chinese are in the middle of their own civil war. Chiang Kai-shek is chasing Mao Zedong and the communists into China. This is where his dude say, "Chiang, why don't you go fight the Japanese?" And he was like, "Eh, no." All right? Japanese like, "My God, you're making this. This isn't even hard. You're fighting yourself. You're not looking. We're just going to go and take it." And to the world, they said, "The Chinese blew up our railroad." No, Japanese blew up their own railroad. Yeah. You don't admit, "Hey, we blew up our own railroad." You want to blame it on the Chinese. All right. They needed an excuse. Yes, sir.
So there are some things like this when I don't understand exactly how like truth comes out about because the Japanese won in the end.
They will win here early on, but they still have diplomatic relations with the West, and they do lose World War II. And they're like, "Oh yeah, remember that? We actually did that. Yeah. So they did it to invoke the rules of the treaty with China, allowing them to send in their military. Overwhelmingly, everybody in Japan is saying, "Go army, go get them, yes, do that." So everybody is behind Hideki Tojo. So he and the emperor began to expand their military. Nothing is better to fuel an economy than gearing for war. It puts a lot of people to work, back in business. And we're going to go throughout Asia and the Pacific and get more raw materials. By this time, the Japanese government is dominated by military men. You are not going to believe their names, but I'm being 100% honest. Members of the Imperial War Council are old Japanese samurai families. The old ones saw the changing of the world, and instead of hanging on to their feudal empires, they used their wealth and influence to get on the ground floor of Japanese industry. Members of the Imperial War Council, General Honda, Admiral Toyota, Admiral Suzuki, General Kawasaki, all right? Modern, automotive and RTV and industrial equipment. One guy starts a shipping firm and he creates the Mitsubishi Bank. All of these guys are old samurai. And so they're military men, and in their total mindset is, James, are you focused? All right. These guys are tired of what had been going on. They want to get rid of the democratic reforms. They want to get rid of socialists, and even worse than a socialist is someone who puts socialism into practice, a communist. We're going to get rid of those dirty commies, all right? And we're going to go back to doing what we did. Samurai warrior values. School children are now taught them obedience to the emperor. And with the ongoing conflict in China, it's too easy. And in 1937, when the Japanese reattack China, they believe it's going to be a quick victory. They're going to be able to take out all of China. What they don't understand is how big China really is and how many people there are. But China's big. And so they're not able to get that quick knockout blow. So Japan makes a mistake and they join the Rome to Berlin axis. They join Benito Mussolini and Adolf Hitler and they choose their side in World War II. Now the Japanese at this point are 99% pure blood Japanese. There's not a lot of foreign blood in there. They thought their emperor was divine, and they were blessed by the sun because when the sun rose, it shined on Japan first. So literally, Hirohito and Hitler were saying, well, okay, you get Europe, we'll take Asia, the two divine races, and we'll split the Americas between us. There's that new kind of sci-fi dystopian thing, a man in a high castle. I would say it was the book, and now it's out. And it's like, what happens if Japan and Germany would have won World War II? It's kind of wonky and strange. I think it's wonky. Yes, ma'am.
Wait, if America didn't get into the war or got into the war too late, do you think there was a chance that Germany and Japan could have won World War II?
I think it would have taken more than two atomic bombs. Yeah. I mean, Europe was almost locked down. Japan would have eventually... Yeah, well, I don't know. I just think Japan just didn't have enough industrial resources. Yes, sir.
What do you think would have happened if we, instead of dropping the bombs, made a landing there?
Oh, I think the casualties would have been in the millions. So while it's not an easy choice for President Truman, 170,000 or conservative 2 million, as high as 5 million, what do you do?
What about in terms of like geopolitical?
What do you mean?
How would it affect the way that the world works today?
Let me finish this, and then we will go on to that. You see all that in red? Those are going to be the Japanese conquests of Asia. We focus on Pearl Harbor, but at the same time Pearl Harbor was being attacked, Japan was on a blitzkrieg from Burma, Myanmar, throughout Southeast Asia, down into New Guinea and Malaysia. All of this they captured on December 8th across the international dateline. Hideki Tojo convinces the emperor, in order to secure resources for their growing empire, they needed to be safe in the Pacific. The only threat to them was the United States Navy at Pearl Harbor. So on December 7th, they attacked the United States Naval Base and Pearl Harbor, and it turns World War II into a truly world war as the United States enters, and there are battles fought on every continent except Antarctica. Yes, there was a battle in South America. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay, I was going to ask, like, what was the extent of, like, the South America involvement in World War II?
It was a major naval engagement called the Battle of the River de la Plata in, like, Uruguay, Paraguay.
Wasn't there something with, like, Mexico trying to take over the U.S.?
Oh, no, that was Germany sending...
The Zimmerman telegram.
Yeah, sending to Mexico and saying, hey, join us.
Don't you actually think that was the British now trying to trick the Americans into...
No, MI5 uncovered it. So maybe they made it up, or maybe they did. Yes, sir.
There was a war down on American soil.
Pearl Harbor.
I didn't think we owned
it. It was an American territory. And in Alaska. The Japanese attacked Alaska. And, like, the Dutch Harbor ice fishermen literally fought the Japanese. And they lured them into, like, a canyon and dynamited it. And Avalanche was like, whoa. You want to play?
I love this.
Just North America.
Okay.
All right, Christina.
We have a restriction.
Oh, well, you have like 1 minute. Hang on. They're gonna make an announcement. Admiral Yamamoto simply says, "I fear we have nothing. We have done nothing but awoken a sleeping giant." And so this nationalism is now going to apply to gentlemen, to the Americas. As now America's nationalistic pride gets involved in World War II. So nationalism is having pride in your country and believing that you are better than others. It can be a positive, but it can be seen as a big negative as we are getting into the age of imperialism. I'm going to maybe do a 10-minute intro in imperialism. Please watch that tonight. Sixth period, most of them are going to be gone to register, so I'm going to have them watch this. But when we come in tomorrow, do I see you tomorrow? No, Friday. No, I will see you tomorrow.
Friday.
We are going to really crush imperialism and get to World War I. Paul, or Hans, could you hit stop for me, please? Thank you, guys.